both the people here having practices, but it's something that we used to do often when I was a youngster. And so if you get a songbook, share a songbook probably, because it's going to be on page 109. This is a song we used to sing. I used to say that to sing for the first snow, and the song Quieter Than Snow. But a little bit of history. Brenda and I started out on this long road of music. I was 18 and she was 16. And we've been playing in church ever since. Brenda has gotten much better, and I haven't improved one bit. But we've been willing to serve the Lord this way. And this is one of those songs that was always a blessing to me as a kid growing up, and then has continued to be. But we haven't sung it here probably in 5 years or more. And so the other instruments are probably just going to be a piano and us. And a few of you will know the song, and we'll power through this. We'll do all right. On the second verse.
Lord Jesus, look down from your throne in the skies and help me to make a complete sacrifice. I give up myself and whatever I know. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Just
Considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Okay, would you come forward, please?
That's actually next week, though.
Is it?
Really? As in next week's communion?
Oh, really? Well, I'm going to finish. I'm on a roll.
You can stand if you like.
I count my cost.
And judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death, and was numbered with the transgressors, for he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Then Hebrews 12:2 says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Jesus, Son of God.
There may have been a little tiny miscue between when we're serving communion, and so we need to make sure that my communication with our worship team is good. I really appreciate it. The selection of music and the scripture reading. It was worshipful, whether or not we're doing communion. We'll do our communion time next week. If you have your sermon notes handy, would you take those out, and we'll take a look at those as we work our way through the message today. And I supposed to have said children, you're dismissed to children's church, but while I was looking down, they left, didn't they?
Yeah.
All right. Well, have a great day, folks. Okay. As soon as we get our slides up here, we'll get going on this. We're in the book of Revelation, and while she's getting that up, I just want to remind you, in case you don't know this, that we're in phase two in Washington State. That means you can go to a restaurant today.
Not till midnight tonight?
He made a concession.
You're going to take out. So anyway, so what's the big deal with Valentine's Day? That's today. Okay, I'm telling you all, and guys, you can just fake it and say, yeah, I know that. But anyway, so what's the deal with Valentine's? Just a little history. There is so much legend and fanciful stories associated with him that I wasn't sure what all was true and what wasn't, but here's what I've been able to garner. He was a priest. Valentinus was a priest in the early church way back. And they were finding that the Roman soldiers, as they would go to war, were much more hesitant for those who were married. They wanted to take care of their family, and so the emperor made it illegal for a Roman soldier to get married, and he wanted to draft them all so he could be victorious. And so no one would marry these fellows when they fell in love with a young girl, except Valentinus. And Valentinus would marry these, and he would get in so much trouble with the emperor, they would arrest him and beat him, and he kept doing it, and as a priest, he would only marry Christians to Christians, and he was leading a lot of people to faith in Christ, which kind of like messed with the emperor's head. It's sort of like the goon squad on a hockey team. Now, they're not supposed to admit that they have a goon squad. You know what a goon squad is on a hockey team? They go out there and mess people up just because that's what you do in hockey, okay? But they just, he kept getting into trouble this way. And finally, when he was in jail, he was witnessing to his jailer. And so his jailer says, look, if your God is so all-powerful and worth following, I have a blind daughter at home. Why don't you go come home and heal her? And so that jailer took Valentinus home to his place that evening. And Valentinus prayed for this young lady, and the story is that she was healed. She regained her sight. She could see, and that jailer was converted to Christ that very night, him and his entire family. Now, some point out that maybe this Valentinus was attracted to this young girl, and they had a romantic relationship, but before he was hauled off and executed, he wrote her a letter to stay faithful to the Lord, stay faithful to her walk. And he signed it from your Valentine. And it wasn't so much a letter of romance as it was an encouragement to stay strong in the Lord. And so Valentinus is known today as the love guy and the little Cupid one that shoots the arrows and all that kind of stuff. But don't miss the real meaning of someone who sacrificed his life. And eventually he was stoned and he was beaten, and it didn't seem like he'd die. So they beheaded him just to make sure that he died. And I thought, that'll put an end to it. It never did. And the gospel has continued on up to this day. Now it's our job to make sure that it goes forward. That's just a little bit of history on Valentine's Day. Okay, as we look at, we're looking at a summary interlude. And this big thing about the summary interlude is whereas chapters 12 and 13 are a summary of salvation history, chapter 14 is a summary of tribulation history, not necessarily in specific order, but all together, the summary, different the events that happen. And so it starts off with the rapture of the church and followed by the 7 years of the tribulation. And right there at the beginning were the seven sealed judgments, and there was the halfway point, and then we're catching up here to it. Now, for those of you in the car, I have given one of these charts to you. The rest of you can download it offline. The seven trumpet judgments after just before the millennial return of Christ, followed by the seven bowl judgments. And then we began a four sermon series on this. There was the worship in Zion, what it would be like in Zion in the millennial reign of Christ. And then second, we talked about this angel with the eternal gospel, warning the entire earth for the entire time, sharing Christ. And then there's the wrath of God that primarily takes place during the second half of the tribulation, but really extends to the entire tribulation period. And finally today, we're looking at the woe on earth. And that will bring us to the fourth message from the 14th chapter of the book of Revelation. And that little chart that you see up on the screen, if you're in the parking lot, you have one in your bulletin. If you're sitting here in the room with us now, or you're watching online, you can download this from this. It'll be right along with the sermon notes if you wanted to go to either Facebook or YouTube to do that.
But that gives us an idea of where we're headed there. So if we look at the summary tribulation, summary of the tribulation history, this whole area that is foreign to us right now. Let me ask, how many of you have been, I'm going to take a chance. How many of you have been reading Romans chapter 1, or today, this morning, as a part of our reading program, read Romans 1, 2, and 3? Can I get it?
Put my hands up here.
Boy, if you haven't, I encourage you to do that today. Romans 1, 2, and 3 is showing us exactly what's going to take place during this period of time. In fact, all the stuff that we see happening on the news and in our national government and around, it's kind of like a trailer for the full-blown deal when we get to the tribulation. But as we begin to look at this theme today, I think about the time of the year that our attention turns to garden work. We are so far from garden work right now. Remember back in the spring last year? I know it's hard to think about tilling your ground because you can't even shovel all the snow that's out there. But there's that whole idea of in your garden, you plant your garden, you clear the ground, you clear the area, you pull out all the winter weeds, you add the fertilizer, you smooth the ground, you carefully plant in rows or little hills, and you water and you weed it and you wait it. First sign when that little bean pokes its head above the dirt in there, and the little shoot begins to come up onto the ground. Some of you are doing some of your starts right now in little dirt pots in your windows and so forth. Eventually you see the leaves develop, and then you see buds come out and blossoms, and then by that time you would have planted them in the ground. You continue to water, you continue to wait, and then you got to get the slug bait out. Then you got to get the pellet bin out for the rabbits that make their way in here. And you watch as the blossoms turn to some small produce, and at times you have to watch a little longer. And I'm learning that here in this valley, that's why people in the summertime lock their car doors so others don't put extra zucchini they can't get rid of inside of a car that's unlocked. But finally, and when the harvest comes, and there really is a parallel over all of the nurturing along of our garden until the harvest time. Well, the passage we're going to study today in Revelation is about the harvest of the earth. And we're going to get into that in somewhat of a detail. Again, it's only a summary of other things we will see later on when we continue to study the book of Revelation and future chapters. It'll take us into greater detail. These past 4 weeks that we have been working our way through these elements within chapter 14, they're only summary spots that summarize events that will take place in much greater detail as we work our way through the book of Revelation. Since the foundation of the world, God planned his garden. Yes, we got to keep the slugs and the weeds out. But for centuries, God has given instructions for the future. And here we're going to begin to take a look at this. On your sermon notes, there's two major sections, 1 and 2, with a bunch of subpoints. Number 1 is the harvest of righteousness, verses 14 through 16. Let me just read that, if I could, please. Then I looked, and behold, a white cloud. And sitting on the cloud was one like a son of man, having a golden crown on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, "Put in your sickle and reap, for the hour to reap has come, because the harvest of the earth is ripe." Then he who sat on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was reaped. These words, angel and harvest and reap, they're all really key words for understanding this passage. And they're found in other New Testament passages. I want to turn our attention to Matthew 13 to kind of get a little bit of background behind some of the thoughts of harvest. And then it goes in here in a differentiation of different things that happen in harvest. Here Jesus in Matthew 13 is explaining some parables to his disciples. and about the kingdom of heaven. So I'm going to plug in Matthew 13. I'm going to plug in about verse 36. It says in Matthew 13, 36, then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples came to him and said, explain to us the parable of the tares of the field. And he said, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man, and the field is the world. And as for the good seed, these are the sons of the kingdom, and the tares are the sons of the evil one. And the enemy who sows them is the devil, and the harvest is at the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. So just as the tares are gathered up and burned with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age. And the Son of Man will send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all stumbling blocks, and those who commit lawlessness, and throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has an ear, let him hear. Now I want to, just for the sake of time, drop down to verse 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet cast into the sea and gathering fish of every kind. And when it was filled, they drew it up on the beach, and they sat down and gathered the good fish into containers, but the bad they threw away. So it will be at the end of the age, the angels will come forth and take out the wicked from among the righteous, and will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So in this passage, there's a hint for us to show what's going to be happening. What Jesus prophesied in Matthew 13 is really being fulfilled here in verse 14. So who is the harvester? We're going to take a look at that in verse 14, because that's important for us to take a peek at that here. In verse 14 it says, then I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and sitting on the cloud was one like a son of man, having a golden crown on his head, and a sharp sickle in his hand. One like a son of man. That harkens back to Daniel chapter 7, starting in verse 13. And Daniel says, I kept looking in the night vision, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man was coming. He came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. Now, even in the New Testament, in Luke chapter 19, it says, and Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Well, now we're beginning to see that the Son of Man is Jesus Christ himself. He, in this passage, will be the harvester. John saw it in chapter 1 of Revelation, verses 12 and 13. He said, Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. Do you remember those lampstands we talked about? And in the middle of the lampstands, I saw one like a son of man, clothed in a robe, reaching to his feet, and girded across his chest with a golden sash. We know that to be Jesus Christ. Now, this golden crown, spoken of in verse 14, I just kind of want to hearken back a little bit to the book of Psalms. In Psalm 132, starting in verse 17, there I will cause the horn of David to spring forth. We know that to be Jesus. I have prepared a lamp for mine anointed. His enemies I will clothe with shame, but upon himself his crown shall shine. The King of Kings, the ruler of the universe, this is Jesus himself. There's so much to cover here. My goodness, sometimes I have to wonder, what am I going to say or what am I going to leave out? Okay, let me go one more in Psalm. Psalm 21, and verses 1 through 5. O Lord, in your strength the king will be glad, and in your salvation how greatly he will rejoice. You have given him his heart's desire, and you have not withheld the request of his lips. For you meet him with the blessing of good things. You set a crown of fine gold on his head. He asked life of you. You gave it to him, length of days forever and ever. His glory is great through your salvation, splendor and majesty you place upon him. And so this one that sits on this on this cloud, and he has a sharp sickle in his hand. And this sharp, it's a long curved knife. It's used for the harvest of grain or other crops in there. And in here we see that it's time for the harvest of righteousness, reaping the earth. And we'll see more about that in just a moment. So we have this picture of Jesus coming. He's got the sharp sickle in his hand, sitting on a cloud with a golden crown on his head. And then letter B in your outline is, who is this messenger? Well, we see in verse 15, another angel came out of the temple, crying out with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, "Put in your sickle and reap, for the hour to reap has come, because the harvest of the earth is ripe." Harkens back to the time when Jesus was saying, the fields are white in the harvest. So pray the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into the field. As the harvest of the righteous comes about, those people who have come to faith in Christ during the tribulation, Jesus is ready himself to take home his tribulation saints in preparation for a massive global judgment. Then the messenger comes. Now notice where the messenger comes from. It's a temple angel. And if you notice that on your notes there, it has a little one, because there's another temple angel that's going to come out in just a little bit. We don't want to mix them up. That comes from the very presence of God. God the Father will send the word when it's time to gather those who have given their faith to Jesus. And the message is that the harvest of the earth is ripe. All souls who are coming to Christ have come. All souls who have come to Christ have suffered enough. All souls who have come to Christ are now to receive their reward. Now, as I studied through this passage, just so many questions just bombarded my head. And my thought is, why does an angel have to tell Jesus when it's time to initiate the harvest? Everything else points to Christ. But then I read in the passage in Matthew 24, it says, "No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son of Man, but only the Father." So when it's time, when the time is right, the Son is waiting, and the Father communicates that through this angel that comes out, and the earth is harvested. Verse 16. And that brings us to a kind of a conclusion for this, or I mean the reward there that's coming. Now watch this in verse 16. "Then he who sat on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was reaped." Now we think of that as being a painful process, but it's a gathering. It's a gathering process. As Jesus in the end time swings his sickle to gather the tribulation saints, he takes them unto himself for their reward. None of the parable gives us kind of the whole picture. Each one of them describes little parts of this as we work our way through. But there is a reward for the righteous. The reward is more detailed than other parables. In fact, in Matthew 25, it says, "His master shall say to him at the end, when there is a reward for their faithfulness, 'Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And also, one who had received the 2 talents came up and says, 'Master, you have entrusted 2 talents to me, and see, I have gained 2 more talents. And his master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful in a few things. I put you in charge of many more things. Enter into the joy of your master.'" So in this parable of the wheat and the tares also, before that, there is a reward that is brought unto God. So after those who have been faithful are gathered, after those who are classified as the wheat are reaped and gathered, what's left? It's the tares. It's those who have done evil. And that's where a harvest of wickedness would come in. In verses 14 to 16, a harvest of wickedness. That's not true. 17 to 20. If you notice up in the sermon notes on the screen are hopefully different than what you have in your hand. I make mistakes a lot, and this one Marilyn didn't get, so don't blame her. But there is a harvest of wickedness in here, and we want to hear about the harvest herb in verse 17. And another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. So we'll put this one up here on the screen. This is the number two angel that came out of the temple. This harvester is different from the first. Whereas the harvest of the righteous is Jesus, the harvester of the wicked is an angel or a messenger from the very presence of God. Now just think back all over Bible history as you read through your Bible. God warned people in the days of Jonah. God warned people in the days of the prophets. God warned people in the days even of Jesus. God warned people in the days of the early church. God has warned them through the ages. God is giving a warning today. God is warning. So in the tribulation, when this happens, God is not unfair. But this day we're talking about right now is the day of the harvest. Enough is enough. The line has been drawn. In this period of time, the harvester who would have continued to, will reap those who have continued to reject or put off Christ. That God has given them every single opportunity and chance that he could for ages past and ages forward, but now is the time. The harvester, the temple angel, is standing at the door. We also want to talk about the messenger that's here. Verse 18. Then another angel, the one who has power over fire, came out from the altar, and he called with a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, "Put in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters from the vine of the earth, because her grapes are ripe." This is called, I'm going to call it the altar angel. The altar angel. He had the power of fire. As I look out throughout scripture, when I see fire coming down from heaven, does that usually mean a blessing's coming or judgment's coming? Judgment, absolutely. And this element here of fire was associated with the judgment. God has so assigned this angel the power of eternal flames and pronounced the harvest of the wicked on earth. This is not their eternal punishment just yet, but their earthly. Now catch this. This will be an earthly judgment. That's the whole purpose of the tribulation, is to judge the earth, the physical inhabitants of the earth, for their sinfulness down through the ages. And it comes from the altar. Now, where this altar? I go back. What does it talk about the altar before in the book of Revelation? Well, back in chapter 6, we were talking about the fifth seal, and there was the martyrs that were under the altar. And in verse 9 of chapter 6, it says, "When the Lamb broke the fifth seal, I saw underneath the altar the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of God and because of the testimony which they had maintained. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, 'How long, O Lord, holy and true, will you refrain from judging and avenging our blood on those who dwell on the earth?'" That's what this passage is in Revelation 14 right now. Revelation chapter 6 continues in verse 11. "And there was given to each of them a white robe, and they were told that they should rest for a little while longer, until the number of their fellow servants and the brethren who were to be killed, even as they had been, would be completed." Revelation 14 is a fulfillment of God's promise in chapter 6. Now these martyred souls will be avenged. Now the system of Babylon and the worshipers of the beast, the rejectors of Christ, will be judged for their sins on the earth. The sins of their soul will be at the white throne judgment later on. This is their judgment on earth. God is faithful, and as he has promised, the persecutors of chapter 6 are called to account in chapter 14. It says that this angel cried out with a loud voice. He cried out with a loud, and I was tempted, let me just shout as loud as I can. Well, that's not going to do any good. Number one, it's not going to impress you. make you irritated more than you already are. And I'll come nowhere as close to what this angel will sound like, because no one will miss it. No one on the face of the earth will miss this. The voice of authority, the voice of decision, the voice of accountability, the voice of God. And now, here is the fulfillment of the promise of the Lord made to these martyred souls waiting under the altar in heaven. So we've kind of had a repeating cycle here. Here, the harvester is the temple angel, number two, the messenger is the altar angel. And what is the conclusion? Verse 19. So the angel swung his sickle to the earth and gathered the clusters from the vines of the earth and threw them into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden outside the city, and blood came out from the winepress up to the horse's bridle for a distance of about. And different versions will talk about stadia or furlongs or whatever, and we'll get to the distance of that in just a moment. Now, this passage in Revelation 14, again, it's just a snapshot, it's just a summary, overview of all of the traumas, and we're going to look at this in greater detail as we move farther along. But in the prophecy of Joel, way back in Joel chapter 3, some 800 years before Christ, looked forward and spoke of this day. In Joel chapter 3, starting in verse 11. Hasten and come, all you surrounding nations, and gather yourselves there. Bring down, O Lord, your mighty ones. Let the nations be aroused and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, which means God's judges. For there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Some of those called it Har Megiddo. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come and tread, for the winepress is full. The vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon grow dark, and the stars lose their brightness. The Lord roars from Zion and utters his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens of the earth tremble. But the Lord is a refuge for his people and a stronghold for the sons of Israel. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. So Jerusalem will be holy, and strangers will pass through it no more. This is a description of the great battle of Armageddon, or Har Megiddon. And it's that whole Jezreel Valley area. And we're going to get to that more in Revelation chapter 19. But here in 14, it's just a passing overview. And it talks about these ripe clusters. When Marilyn and I moved into our house here in Wenatchee, we had the backyard was filled with grapes, these purple grapes just hanging off. And they were growing wild. They were way up in the arborvitae, growing through the junipers. At least they formed some good purpose. They were a grape rack and other places in there, and we enjoyed that. And so most of the time we think of grape harvest, we think of something sweet and good. But here, the picture is when you crush the grapes and all of that juice runs out. It's a picture of all of the bloodshed that will take place during the Battle of Armageddon. It's not a pretty picture. It's not something that we would think of as being positive. The time has come. No more warnings. The vat of God's winepress or wrath. Now, when Marilyn and I take our grapes and process them, we put them in a big steamer and it just heats up really hot and all this luscious juice drips down. Oh, I love that homemade grape juice. No, we don't leave it on the back porch 6 months before we drink it. But the whole idea of this rich, red-looking fluid comes out, it's a picture of the blood that will be shed on there. And the way that they cross their grapes, they put them in a big vat. And then what do they do? Take off the shoes and socks and crush it. And as they crush these grapes, all the juice would come out and flow down through a little trough and fill their wine vats that way. And they would be trodden outside the city, the same place where Jesus was crucified. His enemies will be dealt with in a massive battle. It says in Revelation 14:20, and the winepress was trodden outside the city, and the blood flowed from the winepress as high as a horse's bridle. All right, Riley? Bridle. What part of the tack is that? Goes around their face and their mouth, right? Horses are all different kinds of sizes, but about how high off the ground is a horse's bridle? 5 feet, all right? So it says here, she's used to some big horses up there, too, aren't you? And we're not talking a Shetland pony here, we're talking about the big ones here. It will flow from the winepress, the blood will flow from God's winepress as high as the horse's bridle, 5 feet. And then it says, for a distance, it'll flow for a distance. And the King James uses the word 1,600 furlongs. Other versions use the word 1,600 stadia. That process is out somewhere between 185 and 200 miles. A blood flow 5 feet high for 185 to 200 miles. Israel itself is under 200 miles from top to bottom. It will be a massive battle. 200 million men in an army plus horsemen. This is the sixth trumpet judgment that we've already discussed before. The remaining people will be drafted into a revolt against God himself under the banner of the Antichrist, and the massive destruction, the Battle of Armageddon, who rejected God, the result will be a blood flow that will be 5 feet high and almost 200 miles long. Earlier this week, as I was talking to some others of the men in our prayer group, they were saying, so how's I going to tie into Valentine's Day? I don't have a clue, other than the fact that God loves you and he wants you within. He doesn't want you at this particular place. Noah was safe in the ark as God judged the world. Lot was safe outside of Sodom and Gomorrah as God judged that city. The Israelites were safe under the Passover lamb's blood as God judged Egypt. Christians are safe from the tribulation through the rapture as God judged the earth. The tribulation saints, those who accept Christ during the tribulation, will be safe in heaven because of the first harvest that comes through. Now God will judge this period of time. He's not obligated to ignore the rejection of those people who rejected him. God is a God of justice. Because he is also a God of love, he's offering that warning. We're hearing this warning today, so that we don't have to even be a part of this in any way. It's not a pretty sight, but it is totally avoidable. I can't think of a more graphic warning. He's saying there's going to be two harvests. One will be the harvest of the righteous. Even before that, there was the harvest of the rapture. And then for those who have come to faith in Christ, there's the harvest of the righteous there. And then those who didn't, those who continued to reject, to put it off, to ignore, to revolt, and even curse God and walk away from him, eventually God draws the line and says it's too late now. And that's that harvest that we have read there. So where do we take this home? How do we get even a take it home from this? As you read the book of Revelation, I come back to the three major points of application here. And this kind of cycles itself all the way through in the book of Revelation. The first is salvation. People, this is avoidable. This is altogether avoidable. Coming to faith in Christ, surrendering your heart, you got nothing to lose but a life of misery and condemnation. That's the only thing that we got to lose. And we got everything to gain through your life to Christ. But then second to that, for those who have come to faith in Christ, there's that big old theological term, sanctification. And sanctification simply means turning your back on the sin that has plagued your life and turning to say yes to him. No to sin, yes to God. It means to grow up spiritually. The word sanctified means set apart. And the end result is, I'm setting aside the junk in my life as a believer that would plague me. When I first came to Christ, brand new Christian at the age of just almost 13 years old, I'm ashamed to admit this, but I could cuss the paper off the wall. I had a filthy mouth. I learned to be bilingual so I didn't get in trouble in front of my parents, but with my friends, I could cuss with the best of them. I'd make a sailor blush. Nothing against sailors in the room here, Native people. But as God began to get a hold of my heart, that's one of the first things that He changed. I didn't do it. He just took it away. It's just gone. And I was amazed. Once in a while, I let a little word slip out like that, and it caught me by surprise, and people turn around and look at me and says, "Hey, I thought you was a Christian," and they didn't talk like that. Well, it surprised me too. But I was surrendering that to Him. Other things in my life, I still have to surrender on a regular, ongoing basis. He took some things away, and He says, "Mike, you're going to have to work with me on some other ones." And so I continue to work with Him. But that's sanctification, it's a process that we work through, say no to the sin in our life, and yes to the holiness that He wants to guide us through. That's true for all of us who claim the name of Jesus. And then the final S is sharing. As I stand here watching out the window, occasionally I'll see a state trooper pull somebody over out there. I haven't seen anything today. But these people, and I'm not making a judgment call on them, but people out there need the Lord. They need to know Jesus. And the only way they're going to know it is not if somebody else tells them. It's if you tell the people in your circle. It's not as though you have to bring in the big guns, some evangelist, or bring in the pastor, and somehow they're supposed to get them all fixed up. People don't want to listen to me. In your world, they want to listen to you. What do you have to say? So each one of us is placed in our own sphere, our own neighborhood, our own work environment, our own school environment, our own group of friends, our own community in which we live, and the people with which we interact. You're there for a purpose, and that's to help share the good news. They'll listen to you way more than they'll listen to me. So that's kind of a review. Salvation, sanctification, and sharing. That's kind of an application for each one of us to come across. Each one of us to be able to apply what we're hearing here today. And then finally, read what's going to prepare us for what's happening next. In Revelation 15, it's not a very long chapter at all. It's fairly short. But that's going to be the stage that we're going to enter into next. That'll be next week. Read through that every day and let that kind of prepare us for what God is going to bring to the table for us next week. Would you pray with me, please? Father, there are times that I am at a loss for how to end on an upbeat note when your word tells us that there will be judgment and condemnation. But your word, Father, is that which brings us truth, and we dare not avoid it because it's not pleasant. What a good God you are to tell us now, rather than just judge it later. So I pray, Lord, for those within the sound of my voice that don't know Jesus just yet, that you'd help them to cross that line. You'd help someone here within the sound of my voice to share with them, someone to tell them about the good news of Jesus, so they might come to salvation in Christ. And then, Lord, for the rest of us, that you'd help us in our growth and walk with you. That you'd help us to say no to sin and yes to you. And then, Lord, this week, I pray you'll help each one of us to have a spiritual conversation where we can share your love and your truth with somebody else. Thank you, God. What a good God you are. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with us, please? Thank you.
Thank you.